failed. Then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty. So bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for a thousand years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
Okay. And then, shortly after, he gave this speech.
Sir, I have myself full confidence that if all do their duty, if nothing is neglected, and if the best arrangements are made, as they are being made, we shall prove ourselves once more able to defend our island home, to ride out the storm of war, and to outlive the menace of tyranny, if necessary for years, if necessary alone. At any rate, that is what we are going to try to do. That is the resolve of His Majesty's government, every man of them. That is the will of Parliament and the nation, the British Empire and the French Republic, linked together in their cause and in their need, will defend to the death their native soil, aiding each other like good comrades to the utmost of their strength. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. And if, which I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it was subjugated and starving, and our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old.
Okay, key words there. We will never surrender. Okay, listen, Churchill has a parliament that he answers to. And there's a lot of people in that parliament that think the best thing for Britain to do at this point is to cut a deal with Hitler to avoid the onslaught which is about to take place. Churchill refuses that. Okay, and things are going to get really dicey for the British. Okay, now they've already sent the 3 million children away to the countryside. They've been building an air defense system since the end of World War I, knowing that their island at some point may come under attack. But these speeches that Churchill is giving are filled with inspiration for his people because he knows what's about to happen. Okay, and what Hitler's going to try and do is get Britain to surrender before we get into the war. If he can get Britain to surrender and occupy that island, I want you to think about this historical importance here. Because as you guys know, at some point the United States is going to get in this war. And we are going to win this war. But if you think about this, guys, if Britain falls and the United States one day wants to try and liberate Europe from Nazi Germany, we will have to do so from across the Atlantic Ocean. If Britain survives, we have a staging area where we can bring millions of troops, all the planes, all the guns, all the medicine, all the fuel, all the things we need to liberate Europe, just 20 miles off the continent of Europe. If Britain falls, our job of liberating them becomes much more difficult, maybe even impossible. The British have over 1,000 U-boats patrolling the Atlantic to sink our ships. Okay? And so this is daunting. Churchill understands this. I think Roosevelt understands this, but I don't know if the American people, they may understand it, but they're refusing to get involved, even though this is our ally. And they have their backs to the wall. So this is going to be an air battle. The Battle of Britain, okay? And because they now control France, Germany is going to be able to send her bombers, the Luftwaffe, just from across the coast. They also control the west coast of Norway, which they can use bombers from here and here and anywhere. They can send attacks against Britain. Now, as we talked about before, when Blitzkrieg starts, they go after the airfield. They try and take out the RAF, which is the Royal Air Force. Okay? The Brits know that, and they're prepared for it. Okay? So this will take place during the summer and fall months of 1940. There's no official start date or end date to the Battle of Britain. Okay? But it's going to be called Operation Sea Lion. And I have that on the next slide. Okay? And it's a three-phase attack. The first phase for the Germans is to achieve air superiority, to control the skies. If they control the skies, then they can send landing craft. They can send ships over to Britain with their troops on them safely. But they're going to have to deal with the Royal Navy and the Royal Air Force first, okay? Good news, guys. Germany will never get past phase one, okay? And I'm going to tell you why. Now, these are German aircraft losses during the war in six-month periods, all right? Now, one thing you have to remember about this is that every country involved in this war is continually building aircraft. So the ones that are destroyed are replaced over time. Does that make sense? Okay. So in this, between May and December of 1940, during this Battle of Britain, which will take place in the air, Germany will lose 2,572 aircraft, which at that time is 71% of the Luftwaffe. Devastating for the German Air Force, okay? And you can look at these different periods, okay? Now, you get to 1944, we're decimating their Air Force, okay? Now, if you go to Britain, now in this country, what does this mean? Peace, okay? And if you turn this around, Churchill was using this as victory, V, for victory, okay? But if you go to Britain today, do not do this. Does anybody know why? Dan? This in Britain means this. Okay? And what does it go back to, Sam? Why does this mean this?
I don't know. I just haven't done it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
It's
like a nod to the
German. No, it's a human. Okay, so back in the days before the gunpowder and guns, what was a way that you could shoot somebody with bows and arrows, which they're doing in freshman PE right now, okay, archery. And how do you hold the arrow? Pull it back with these two fingers. And then when they catch these archers, they cut off those two fingers. so they couldn't do it anymore. So be careful in Britain doing that, okay?
Yes.
But V for victory, okay?
Wait, so at the time, did it like...
I people kind of laughed it off.
Okay.
But yeah, yeah. Okay, so how did the Britain achieve this success? Okay. And this right here, guys, is one of the main reasons. This aircraft is called the British Supermarine Spitfire. Okay. It was designed by an aeronautical engineer named R.A. Mitchell. Okay. When we talk about the world of aviation, and I've mentioned some great aviators to you, Charles Lindbergh, Billy Mitchell, right? O'Hare. I might have talked about that in this class. But William Moffett, others. So R.A. Mitchell, as we move through, you know, the early part of the century, of course, the Wright brothers, and then they started having contests to see who could build the fastest plane in the world. And they would hold these contests annually in Britain. And there was a prize for the winner. You got $25,000 if you won this race. R.A. Mitchell won this race using a design similar to this 3 years in a row. This has a 1,000 horsepower Rolls-Royce Merlin engine in it. Okay. Now, if you look at the wings of this plane, you see the elliptical wing, yes? This is difficult to manufacture in mass quantity because of the curvature. If you look at most World War II fighter planes, they have a boxed wing with straight edges. Much easier to manufacture, okay? But when they got this plane in the sky, especially at high speeds, because of the curvature of this wing, the elliptical wing, these planes could maneuver better than their German counterpart, okay? Now, as I said, the Germans are going to go after the airfields first. Well, the British are going to know they're coming, when they're coming, what direction they're coming, and how many planes the Germans are sending. Because they have built an air defense system that starts at the coastline with spotters, and then something called radio detecting and ranging, which we call what today? Radar. Now, the British didn't invent the radar. We don't really know who invented it first, but it was invented in different parts of the world around the same time. Okay, there's a pretty good movie, again, I can't remember the name, just came out recently, about the guys that built the first radar station in Britain. He was a weatherman, okay? And he thought he could do this and, you know, had to get funding from the government. It's a pretty good story, okay? So, key factor in the battle, radar.
Oh no.
It's hard to. Uh-oh. So they also had spotters. So guys, what you know, I don't know if you know how radar works. You send out radio waves, it hits something, it bounces back. Okay. Now this is not the type of radar we have today, like Doppler radar. You know, where we can see an actual tornado in the radar. You know what I mean? It's not even close to that sophisticated, okay? But it does tell us when they're coming across the channel, all right?
This is turning off.
I didn't charge it last night. Okay. All right, so the British are going to hide their planes. So wherever their airfields are, there's no planes there. Okay, you can see they're going to camouflage them. They're going to hide them under trees, and stuff like that. And they're going to disperse their airfields into the countryside of southern England. All right. So when you look at old World War II video, when you see these planes taking off, most of them are taking off of grass runways, open fields. Okay. Because they had to hide their planes. But generally what happened was when the Germans came, the RAF went up in the air to meet them. Now, there's other planes besides the Spitfire. There's the Hawker Hurricane, which actually had more Hurricanes than Spitfires because they're hard to build, okay? And so as soon as the radar showed that there was planes coming, and because it's water between Britain and France, those radio waves don't get blocked by anything. You know what I mean? So it works pretty well. They know when it's coming. And then they have spotters at the coast to tell you, give you the altitude of the planes and the direction. The radar helps with the directions of the planes. So in London, guys, all of this was wired in from the coastline to London. Okay. And they had a room about, this, you know, a little bit bigger than this with, you know, how you have a track around some of the gymnasiums in the city, right? So you've got like a room and a big map of Britain on the floor. Like the map's the size of this room. Okay. And young women like your age are going to be on a radio headset. Okay. The radar operators are going to radio to these women. Okay. And they're in this big room, you know, with the map of Britain. Okay. And the airfields are dispersed all over down here. Okay. And so they're going to get on the radio and radio the airfield. The pilots are just sitting around in like little shacks, drinking a pint of beer, and the phone rings, and they ring a bell. And these pilots literally sprint to their planes and get up in the air before the German Luftwaffe reaches the coast. So every single time the Germans came to attack, they were met by enemy aircraft, by the Royal Air Force. Guy, yes. Right. So what are you saying?
So I'm saying if they get into a protracted dogfight, they're going to either.
Yeah, they're going to have to leave at some point. Yes. Yeah. So at first they would send the big bombers, right? And then the bombers started getting shot down. So then the Luftwaffe would send their fighters to shoot down the British fighters so that they wouldn't shoot down their bombers. Follow me? Okay. And so these women that were working in this map room, they would be on the radio with the pilots in their planes, okay, helping to direct them. So they were on the radio with these pilots as they were in dogfights, as they were getting shot down, as they were dying. Okay, and the losses on both sides are very high. Okay, these planes were very effective, but so were the Messerschmitts. Okay, so it, you know, what they quickly figured out, the British, was it takes a lot longer to train a pilot than it does to build an airplane. So they encouraged their pilots, if their plane was damaged or they were going to go down, to eject from the airplane. Because they were running short on pilots. At one point during the Battle of Britain, they figured they needed more pilots. There were three Polish pilots that had escaped Poland, okay? There were Czech pilots that had escaped Czechoslovakia. And then I spoke to you guys about American pilots, ones that went to Canada to get fake papers. These are like crop dusters and mail delivery guys that fly airplanes, civilians in America, okay, that wanted to go over and fly on behalf of the RAF. So you had mixed units of different languages, which made it difficult because the Poles didn't speak English very well, okay? But they were taking whatever pilots they could at that, you know, at that case. Guys, there were times that the British pilots were shot down over the English Channel, picked up, they parachuted out, picked up in the water by British boats, back in an airplane later that day. Because the Germans just kept coming. Okay? And when they couldn't take out the airfields, and the German losses were heavy, they started attacking the cities. London, Coventry, Liverpool, Manchester. So the blackouts, guys, you guys know what a blackout is. The British took these very seriously. Any guys ever flown at night? Yeah, you can see where the cities are. You know what I mean? But if you turn off all the lights at night, it's much harder to see the lit cities. So like in London, guys, they had what was called the Home Guard. And if you let any light out of your house, you would get fined. Okay? They had to cover the all the train cars. They had to cover all the windows in the train cars, every home, every business. They covered the headlights of their automobiles. They shut off all the street lamps in the city. So, I mean, it's like pitch black in London at night. There were a lot of accidents. Like people just, you know, walking into things, hurting themselves, falling off of curbs, you know, falling into the river and drowning. You couldn't see it. It was pitch black. Okay. We practiced these blackouts in the United States as well. Even in Kansas, we're in the middle of the country. We practiced them in Wichita. They had, you know, in New York City, they took it more serious. Gave these blackouts. All right, but it was something they had to do. So how did the British counter that? So they start attacking the cities. Well, let me, I do have a few videos here. I don't know if some of these will work, some of them won't. I'm just going to open all of them over there on my computer and see which ones work. Oh, that one's working. Oh, okay, that was okay. This one. Okay. You guys have seen this before, but I'm going to use it as a segue. This is the very beginning of the movie. Okay, so what you're seeing here is the Junkers 88, the big German bomber. What you're seeing there is the anti-aircraft fire, flak. Bombing at night makes it harder for the RAF to shoot them down.
I don't remember that being that intense.
Yeah, it was pretty intense. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about that shelter they went into in the backyard. Are you going to work?
That's the Dunkirk one.
See if I can find a short video here. Okay, that you guys know, Britain is notorious for rainy weather.
Yeah.
Okay, that summer, guys, the skies were fairly clear. So if you lived on the southern coast, you got to watch this take place every day. This is Spitfire versus a Messerschmitt.
Sah gut aus. Daneben.
Here. So you can see these are just some of the routes that the Germans took to bomb Britain from the coast here. Okay. And then this is the artist's depiction of the Spitfire and the German Messerschmitt. Okay, that a couple different models, the 109, the 110, and so forth. Okay. But in this air battle, the head of the German Luftwaffe is a guy named Hermann Göring. Okay, and if you go back and you read about this, Göring's a large man. He's a hefty guy. Okay, so if you ever see video of Hitler and this large man standing next to him, that's Hermann Göring. And Göring was supposed to knock out the British within weeks. This was going to be over. Okay, but the British were stubborn. All right, and Churchill, guys, when they started bombing the cities, for 6 months they bombed the cities. People wanted to surrender. You understand? They wanted this to be over. But Churchill and the royal family stayed in London. Now, the royal family did send some of their family jewels to Canada, like a lot of the gold and artwork and stuff like that, okay? But they stayed. They could have left. Churchill stayed in the heart of London. And you can go there today to London and see what were called the War Cabinet Rooms. Very inconspicuous. You got a row of apartment buildings and then a park. At the end of that row of buildings, you go down around the side, downstairs, underground. And that's where Churchill ran the war from in the middle of London. So after these bombings took place at night, Churchill would be out amongst the people with them. He stayed with them. You understand? Which is huge for morale. Okay, to know that their leader was in the midst with them. Okay, and the royal family for that matter. But Hermann Göring was asked by Hitler, he said, how come you can't defeat these Brits, the Royal Air Force? What do you need to defeat them? And he said, get me a squadron of Spitfires and I'll defeat the British. This plane helped save Western civilization. You understand? This battle changes the course of human history. If the Brits don't survive here, we have to invade from across the Atlantic. Okay, so that's kind of what I'm spending time on. I know I'm going to give you way more information than you need to know about the Battle of Britain. Okay? Certainly more than would take up a four-point answer on a test. Some pictures. This is that full picture of Churchill with the Tommy gun. Great photograph. Okay. And this is what Churchill said about the Royal Air Force. Listen to these words. He said, and never in the course of human history have so many owed so much to so few. He's talking about the pilots of the RAF. Never in the course of human conflict have so many, all of us, okay, owed so much to so few. Now, here's a picture of Churchill. This is after a bombing raid, what the British referred to as the Blitz. Okay. And so he's out there amongst the people. Okay. These are some children. And guys, I wrote a couple of big papers on this battle. Okay. I've got one here in my desk. Citizen survival tactics and home defensive measures during the Battle of Britain. Citizen Fortress, Britain. Pretty good stuff. Okay, I got an A. Yeah, it's a graduate school paper. Okay. Now, some of these children, remember the phony war was 6 months long. They sent 3 million children to the countryside, but nothing happened for 6 months. So some of the kids that were really missing their parents, like, tried to come home. And their parents were gone. And then the bombing started. So as some of these authors that I researched on this described, you had these groups of children, like 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, that had nowhere to live. And they're like little hoodlums, you know, they were stealing food and causing problems, and there was nobody to look out for, okay, these bands of children, okay? So the reason you see this rubble from the bombing, the reason why in the movie Narnia they showed them going back into the backyard, because the British government provided every citizen that wanted one what's called an Anderson shelter. Okay, now this is what it looks like when you're building it. The one they have in the movie is really nice. I mean, it looks like it had carpet in there and beds and stuff. Okay, most of them weren't that nice. Okay, so you dig a hole in your backyard about 3 feet deep. That's why you're underground. You get the corrugated metal and you bolt it together here. And then you, during an air raid, they'll have sirens and you get out of your house, because if your house gets hit, it's going to collapse on you and you're going to die. If you're in your backyard underground in this shelter, you have a chance of surviving. Okay. So a lot of people really didn't spruce theirs up, and it rains a lot. And so you get water in it. And then if you had food stored in there, you get rats and, you know, stray cats and stuff like that living in your shelter, which could be nasty. So you go to London today, there's still a lot of homes with these in the backyard now with gardens around them and stuff like that, okay? Now, have you seen these before? They have these balloons. They're called barrage balloons, all right? And listen, when you're under attack for 6 months from the air, you're going to want to do something to, you know, at least, you know, help survive to fight, to do something, to know that you're attempting. So these barrage balloons, what do you think their purpose is? What's the purpose of this?
To drop stuff.
Distraction? What?
To drop stuff.
Okay.
All right. I feel like you can prove your end with this, but their thing is to explode in the air as they can fly.
Oh, so like you could shoot it and blow it up if it was by a plane?
Yeah.
Okay.
I feel like planes would run into it and get stuck.
Okay, so if you're a pilot and you see one of these, you're not able to avoid it? Shay. No, no, no. Okay. All right. Here's the thing about the. Yeah. Are there what?
Are there people
in the balloon? No. They are about, if we were to cut this room in half, about the size of half of this room. Okay. So we could fit two of these big balloons in here. Maybe they're probably a little bit bigger than that. Okay.
All right.
Now. Couple of purposes. Guys, at the height of the Battle of Britain, there were over 2,100 of these flying in the sky over southern England. Okay. Remember those Stuka dive bombers? Okay. Now, you could place these thousands of feet high in the air. You could put them on the top of buildings and make them even higher. And ladies, there'd be like five of you in charge of one balloon. Okay. The thing about the balloon is this. This is a steel cable. Okay, so if you're a pilot, you don't want to fly into a bunch of these balloons. You want to avoid it. If you're a dive bomber and there's a bunch of balloons around a radar station because they want to take out the radar stations, right? So you put up barrage balloons. Okay, so if you fly into this and your wing hits this steel cable, one of two things is going to happen. It's either going to rip your wing off and you're going to crash and die. Or two, it's going to send you into a spin, okay? Because if you do create enough drag on this, this will pop up, and a parachute will pop out, creating more drag with this. We don't want the five women holding on to this when a plane hits it, you know. Okay? So it's a deterrent, okay? Now, the other thing is, if you're talking about London at night, okay, where you can't see the planes. So if you have these up, the German pilots have scouted at what altitude these balloons are at. So they're going to fly it just above the balloons. Okay, because we're talking pretty low-level bombing here, and under 10,000 feet. And so if you're shooting at them with the anti-aircraft fire that we just watched, the explosions going off, it helps to know what altitude the bombers are flying at. So the Germans would fly just above the balloons, okay? And so it made the anti-aircraft guns more accurate. Now, the British called the anti-aircraft guns AKAK guns, okay? AKAK, all right? And I'll show you a picture of that in a minute, okay? Guys, 2,100 balloons. Now, how often did a pilot fly into one of these or hit one of these? Not very often. But for the British, guys, this is a daily reminder. They're doing something. You know what I mean? The bombs keep coming, but we're trying. We're doing something to defend our island. It's a daily reminder, okay? And that's important. Guys, we had some of these on the west coast of the United States after Pearl Harbor. We put up barrage balloons, okay? The incendiaries, I wrote that word up there a minute ago. The bombs that the Germans started dropping on the cities were incendiary bombs that would cause fires. They would bomb purposefully during low tide. You guys, I don't know if you know the geography here. The Thames River runs through London, okay? And when the river's low, that's where they get the water to put out fires. And so the Germans would purposely use incendiaries when the river was low so that the city would burn, okay? I think it's St. Paul's Cathedral in London. There's a famous picture, I don't have it in here, but of just destruction all around the city, but the cathedral standing, okay? And it did receive some damage, but the dome was never hit. Am I running out of time? No freaking way. Let me talk, how much time? Okay. Real quick, this is a Morrison shelter. So if you had a little bit more money, of course, steel is hard to get during the war. You could put this in your house, put some chicken wire on the outside, put a mattress in it, and if the house came down, the shelter would protect you. Okay, a little safer. Here's radar stations. Okay, and people would go into the tubes. Okay, for safety. This is dangerous. The government during air raids said don't go into the tube, but people want to get underground. There's not enough air raid shelters for everybody. These are built right under the streets, and if a 500-pound bomb hits the road, what's going to happen? And it did. No trains running at that time. And don't hide under bridges during a bombing raid. Bridges are targets. It will fall on you. All right, guys. Battle of Britain. I got a little bit more tomorrow. Okay.
Have a good day.
Thanks.
I don't think I've ever seen it.
Have a good one. Try not you to too. Hit your toe against the
door. Oh, I know. Jeez.
Are you going to record this hour?
Government?
Should I?
Are
you going to be gone?
I'm going to be gone. I have to meet.